Somewhere outside of New York City, modern-day James sits down to watch the news at night.
This is Megan Johnson with the 5 o'clock news. Tonight's story involves a local artist, an amateur YouTuber, who was struck by lightning in Bryant Park. Reports say the artist was delusional and wrapped head to toe in aluminum foil.
Ah, shit. Now we're gonna get another body double. Maybe I shouldn't even worry about these cinematic intros. I'll just do it the way I normally do it. Hey guys, Modern Day James here.
You got eyes on him, Sergeant?
Yeah, I got eyes on the bastard.
All right, proceed.
And unfortunately this week, I don't have any funny skit prepared for you.
I see what you're doing here. Trying to train little soldiers?
What? What are you talking about?
Becoming a GI! A GI! Becoming a GI! You're creating an infantry!
Becoming a geek, like Kim Jong-gi, like the world's best artist! What are you talking about?
I didn't realize. I'm sorry.
Becoming a gi.
So let me show you what becoming a gi is all about.
So the first thing I'm going to do is demonstrate how we can take an object and tilt it in any perspective that we want. Reminiscent of Scott Robertson's How to Draw, we're going to start by establishing our perspective and then creating a center line. Imagine this center line as a paper airplane model of our subject that we can then expand outwards to create volume. If I find that I need to go beyond the bounds of the box that I've created, I simply extend that ground plane a little bit further. In Scott Robertson's version of this technique, he creates many perpendicular cross-sections to solidify the form. But I'm just going to imagine these cross-sections and just start by filling in the details. Because of this, we sacrifice a little bit of accuracy, but as we use fewer and fewer guidelines, our drawings become more fluid. And again, this isn't to say that we shouldn't use guidelines or underdrawings, but separating yourself from them can be very liberating and really allow your imagination to take over. If you're unfamiliar with any of the form building techniques that I'm using, I have a whole series that covers building forms and multiplying curves in perspective. In comparison to that series, I'm using a lot more intuition and estimation here. Certain areas might not be 100% accurate in their placement, but that's okay. Filling in the shadow really solidifies the relationship between the subject and the ground plane. Now I'm adding in some hatching to show a little bit of lighting information and add in some texture. So the basis of the next exercise is to take a single object and view it in many different angles. In order to do that, we first need to be able to draw rectangular forms anywhere in relation to the horizon. To make matters a little more complicated, I'm going to use the 5-point perspective system that I described in last lecture. To reiterate, we have a central vanishing point, a left and right vanishing point, and an upper and lower vanishing point. For our vertical vanishing points, as we move further away from the center, we have increasing convergence. The same is true for our left and right vanishing points. The convergence will increase as we move closer to them, and as we move further above or below the horizon line. The result is a perspective grid that takes on a spherical shape, and it produces pictures similar to that of a fisheye lens. You can have a little bit of fun with this by playing with the convergences of the vanishing points. The closer you move the vanishing points to one another, the more extreme distortions you'll get. Okay, so now let's redraw that grid and fill it in with our subject matter. Again, we'll begin by creating our forms in a 5-point perspective system. I'm attempting to make each bike the same size and perspective, but the distortions will make them appear larger or smaller according to their position. I estimate the ratio of height, length, and width based on observation of photos in orthographic poses. It can be difficult to map the many curving forms of the bike as they move above and below the horizon line. Again, I'm making a lot of estimations here. If you're interested in using more accurate techniques to map these curves, there are many detailed in Scott Robertson's How to Draw. I cover a lot of the early chapters of this book in my perspective series if you want to check that out. Again, I'm really trying to visualize those cross sections as I fill out the major forms of the bike. Once those are established, we can work out secondary problems like the minor details, hatching, and textures. But as I often try to hammer home in these videos, perspective is really the most important foundation of drawing. If you're having trouble with these exercises, try not to get too discouraged. I find them to be some of the hardest things to wrap your mind around, and it really requires you to make a pseudo 3D model in your head. If your drawings aren't coming out like the subject matter you're trying to portray, take a few steps back and use more guidelines. Make sure that you're comfortable drawing the basic forms in perspective. Once you're comfortable with those, it'll be a lot easier drawing a complex subject at any angle. Also, get comfortable calibrating your drawings by making critical observations after each one. If you happen to notice that, say, this bike is too wide, this one too long, or this type of shading doesn't look great, try to avoid repeating these mistakes by explicitly stating them to yourself. Just stay calm and keep at it, and try to be directed with your practice. Alright, now for the final mental hurdle in this video. For me, this was the most challenging exercise. I try to keep the camera in the same position while rotating the subject around a center axis. This initial blockout is reminiscent of the cube turning exercise I discussed in part 1, but now we're going to take it to an even greater level of difficulty. To sum up that exercise, as we turn the form counterclockwise, the left vanishing point will move further from the center as the right will come closer. Once I'm happy with the placement of these forms, I add in 4 ellipses in each to represent the tires. Now again, I'll block in the center line as I did in the beginning of the video. And now I fill in the details and forms, following along with the perspective lines that I've created. Since we have a very low camera in relation to the quad, I add these heavy blacks underneath to show that we're looking up into it. Alright, let's try this again, but now from another angle. Now that the quad is twisting away from us, we're going to see more of the backside of it. And as opposed to the previous example, where the front and back tires were on opposite sides of the center vanishing point, now all of our tires are to the right of the center vanishing point. As a result, as we look into the rim of both tires, we will see the right side. Now twisting away from us even further, we'll see almost the entirety of the backside. There's a lot of texture in these tires, as well as other areas throughout the bike, that will give us the opportunity to do some material indication. I've done this several times in the video already. The strong shadows, followed by strong highlights in the tailpipe and rims, are indicative of chrome material. And filling in that black on the tires is indicative of rubber. Rubber has a bit of a specularity or reflectivity to it. I could have emphasized the highlights a bit more to demonstrate this. And lastly, the quad completely turned away from us, again with the camera at a low vantage point. And while my former self finishes up the last demonstration, I just wanted to thank you guys for all the support that you've been giving to the channel. You guys really do make this possible, and all the feedback that you've been giving has really helped me improve my content. If you like the video, please subscribe and consider supporting us on Patreon. We have a bunch of rewards, from access to the previous live streams, critiques during live streams, and one-on-one lessons. And if you haven't already, join the conversation over on the Discord server. And remember, I'll be live streaming every Friday through Sunday at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, so please come by and check it out. Thanks again, guys.